Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Gospel Life Church. My name is Kayla. So glad that you have chosen to join us this morning. We are excited to worship with you all. We're going to have an opportunity today, later in the service, where you're going to have the opportunity to share what you are thankful for and where you have seen God move. So as we enter into worship today, I want you to be thinking about that. It's the week of Thanksgiving. You're probably going to have to share around your table anyway. So just be thinking about how you've seen God move. And Renee's going to share a few announcements.
Good morning. How are you guys this morning? Good morning. Hey, my name is Renee, if you don't know who I am, and this is your first time here, I just want to welcome you. We have Take 5 over in the corner, so if you're new and you want to just hear some more things about the church or you want to get involved, that's a great place to start, so we encourage you to start there. Also, we are having a cookie Christmas exchange. Woohoo! Who likes cookies? Okay, so I was going to say. Yeah, so we're going to do a cookie exchange December 14th. 2 p.m. through 4 p.m. An email has gone out, so look for the email if you haven't signed up yet. And then I just want to share that we're going to have some opportunities to just express our thankfulness within the service. So I encourage you to think about just what you're thankful for and have just that time to be able to maybe come up and share that with us of what you've seen God do and how thankful you are for what he has done. And last but not least, I want to just thank you guys for all your gifts, your tithes, your offering, your time to the church. We've just seen God grow and expand this campus. I'm just so excited for what he's got coming in the year 2025 for us. So could you just take a minute and pray with me? That would be great. Dear Lord, I just thank you so much for everything that you've done for us, Father. God, I just ask that you would bless this service, Father God, that you would bless Pastor Tay as he prepares to speak. Father, I just pray that the hearts of Thanksgiving would be just pounding and strong, Father. And God, I just thank you for all that everyone has done here for us, Father God. Everyone, their time, just their money, everything, God. We couldn't have done it without that. And so, Father God, I just thank you and I praise you. And I just ask that you would meet each person as they're coming in and preparing their hearts for worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we enter into worship this morning. We sing together, 1,000 tongues. If we had 1,000 tongues, that would be not enough to praise him. Amen. Let's put our hands together.
Triumph of his grace, you are worthy. You
serve a God that is good, that is faithful. Let's continue as we worship Him this morning. Somebody next to you, say good morning. Happy Sunday. So glad you're here.
good morning, church. It is good to see you all on the Lord's Day. Well, as Renee said at the beginning of service, what we love to do every Thanksgiving season is to open up the floor to allow all of us to share. There's something in our lives where we can describe the Lord's goodness to all of us. And I think about Psalm 136. It says this: give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. This would have been a repeated psalm read to the congregation, and they would have replied with that. Give thanks to the Lord, the God, capital G, of all gods, lowercase g, saying there is no other God besides the God in which we serve, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his steadfast love endures forever. And in the last part of verse 4, to him alone does great wonders, for his steadfast love endures forever. So we're going to open up the floor now, and just a couple of us come up and share. Maybe you got a brief story, or if you experience the goodness of the Lord, or maybe you're in a tough season, and you are holding on to the promises of God is near in his presence. So feel free, you come up, you can grab this mic here and share. We'll transition back into worship, and then we'll have a second time of this later. So if you're not going to come the first time, you're going to come the second time, right? All right. Floor's now open if anybody wants to share.
Yeah. I just got to say, God is good. And one of the things that I appreciate most about him is that he is constantly amazing me. He can take a situation that looks like nothing good could come from that and turn it into something beautiful and amazing. He just does that over and over again in our lives, and I'm so thankful for that. I'm also thankful for a grandson who is here this morning for the first time. Ellis Joel Craig is his name. So we are super happy to have him in our family. And thank you, Lord, for that, we would say.
Good morning. Hey, so this year has been a really rough year for our family. We've had some really big losses, and so I've done a lot of questioning, like, why God? And, you know, just really struggling with that. And so last week I was in the car driving to work, and I was praying, and I'm like, God, I don't even know how to handle it. I can't handle it. I don't even know what to do. I can't take anymore. And so this verse, Philippians 4, verse 6 says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And so I just started to pray, and the Lord just really, you know, man, you know, when you start to pray and you're like, okay, Lord, you said pray, so that's what I'm doing. And I found myself by the end of that car ride to work changed. It's like God just took something, you know, those paddles that bring you back to life. I felt like he just went, tuk-tum. And I was like, thank you, Lord. I needed that. I needed that. So I just am super thankful that how much he loves me and cares for me enough to give me that little jolt to say, it's going to be okay. You're going to be okay. Thanks.
Seems like there's a theme this morning already with just things happening in our lives, and we're trying to figure out, like, what do we do? So I'm thankful for 2 Corinthians chapter 4, where it says, so we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. And for me, that light momentary affliction, like whenever I'm going through something, I have to remember back to the word of God, you know, there's just a light momentary affliction, that there's something eternal that awaits me, that can give me joy, can give me hope again, and can help me make it through. So I'm thankful for Paul's writing in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18.
Continue by singing of God's goodness. So I invite you to stand as we sing this song. We'll have another opportunity after this song to come up and share more. We are grateful. Oh, and all my To take your seats, and if you have a moment that you want to sing of the goodness of God, want to come up and share what you are thankful for, I invite you to come up now.
Okay, this is going to sound weird, but I'm thankful for not only answered prayer, but unanswered prayer. I'm thankful for pain. I'm thankful for hard times, because it's during that time that draws me to my knees and keeps me grounded in my faith in the Lord. And I've been meditating like this whole week on Psalm 139, which I love anyway, but how darkness and light are the same to God. None of it is different. He's with us all of the time. It's all light to him. So when I can't see the light, it's still there. That's the reality. Okay, thanks.
Good morning, everyone. I am just so thankful for the Lord and his presence in my life. I've gone through a very tough loss this year, but I've also gone through so many happy things. I got married this year, so that was great. Yeah, I was really happy to go through that, and I was also very grateful to go through the pain that I did go through this year. Isaiah 43:10 says, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my right hand." God is always there, and I'm just thankful for that. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Forever, I always wanted to do vacation Bible school, and it just so happened that they did in the evening, and I was knocked out by all these adorable kids and the wonderful way we all gather as a church and get these kids through four crazy days. And shortly thereafter, I got a call from Josh saying that, you know, Janelle and I worked together, and she thought that I would be good for Awanas. And I've heard Awanas my whole life and really never knew what it was, but oh my gosh, I'm so knocked out by how the Lord moves every Wednesday night through these kids and how they're getting the building blocks to know and love God. And that's so important. And it's just so great to work with everyone. And I have a wonderful church to go to. We're so blessed on so many levels. And I'm so thankful for that, because it has filled a space in my heart that I didn't even know was needing fulfillment. Is that a word? Fulfillment. But I'm just so thankful. I'm thankful for Tay and all that he's going through, and all the prayers and our endless love for him. We just thank you so much, Dave, for everything. So thank you, everyone.
From helping with
thankful for this last 10 and 11 weeks that we have been doing this rooted curriculum. We've seen so much growth in our church, on our worship team. Our worship team did it together, and our small group as well. And I just love that theme verse that we've had, Colossians 2, 6 and 7 says, "Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, established in the faith, just as you were taught, and abounding in thanksgiving." And I think we see that evident this morning, that almost every person that came up here shared a passage of scripture that's been meaningful to them. And that shows a reflection of how our church is in the Word. Amen. And I'm thankful for that we're a part of a church who prioritizes the Word, and that you are a reflection of that, just by giving thanks to God and speaking about what he's saying to you in his Word that is alive and active. And so we give him thanks this morning. Amen. Let's stand as we sing this last song together. Proclaim this morning of your great faithfulness to us. We proclaim of your goodness, Lord, that you have come, given us new days, new mercies every morning. Lord, days that were not promised to us, but that you have blessed us with anyway. We're thankful, God, for all the many things that have been named this morning and the things that haven't been named. God, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus, that we have life and eternal life through him, God. And we praise him this morning. We praise you for the good things that you have done. We ask, Lord, that you'd go before us now as we continue in worship. Would you open our hearts and our minds to the word that you have for us this morning? Would you be given all glory, all honor, and all praise? It's in the powerful name of Jesus that we pray all these things. Amen and amen. You may be seated.
Thank you so much, worship team, and thank you, God's people, for singing and lifting your voice and participating. Thank you so much. Participating in this day, it's one of my favorites of the year, where we get to hear from you all and hear what God is doing in your lives. And so continue to sing his praise on the daily. Well, today looks a little different, more of a devotional style of message and the theme in which we've kind of crafted Thanksgiving at heart. But first, let me give a little update to where we are as a family and then kind of what the next steps will look like. And so we had a follow-up appointment this week. At this point, Samantha, my wife, is still in the midst of tons of pain. Haven't come downstairs much from the home in the last 7 days besides to get something to drink or use the restroom. And so not much of life activity of mom inside of our home at the moment. We went to the doctor on Tuesday to follow up on just where we are in life. And at this point, our oncologist feels the best next step is to put us back on what we call a known medicine, so a medicine that we've already used in the last year or so that has brought some progress. You only can be on this medicine, though, for a short amount of time because of the high toxicity level. And so with that, our hope is that we will begin to start to see a start of the spread. The doctor was very clear. If we do not begin to see that, unfortunately, she said, you were hearing the last words of there's nothing more we can do. And so our hearts are trusting God to do a miracle, and that's it. There's nothing more to say but God, you have to come through and do a miracle. And so we are going to trust in the doctor's plan of medicine and by miracle for God to move to bring healing to Samantha's heart. With that, it gives me a great joy, but also sorrow of, I think, the position that I that I need to take. Begin to work through a process of what it looks like to take a family medical leave, which will probably begin beginning of the new year, just for a season. I want to live the reality of what it means that my family is my first ministry. I'm here today because my wife has shepherded our home so well. She's been a partner in ministry for a long time. And my heart needs to be that I need to respect every moment we have together if the Lord decides not to keep her here on earth. And so, with that being said, I've kind of come up with a plan. I've put it in front of Scott and our elders, which we'll kind of get some more review in the next couple of weeks. And so we'll have a sure plan in the next couple of weeks. But what it will look like here in January, maybe just to preach one time, kind of do our annual meeting. It's a lot to celebrate there. I love to look back and celebrate with God's people at our annual meeting. As of now, to participate in our La Paz mission trip, Bree and myself have worked so hard to get that team going. And then after that, you probably won't see much of me besides maybe a Sunday service or so where I'm just a participator in with God's people. That may take us up to March. This current treatment that we will be on will get us what we call 7 cycles, and so we'll start it in December. Unfortunately, it starts on Samantha's birthday, which is next week, Thursday, after Thanksgiving, December 5th, which will take us up until March, and then we kind of have a clear path of what that will look like there. And so with that, I absolutely love you all. I love this ministry, this campus, this church. And I call us up to take the greater step of ownership. I think in seeing how God has moved in this campus, it's eye-opening and mind-boggling, and it makes me so thankful for the joy of being a shepherd. And so now it's your turn to continue to press forward for kingdom purposes, not for the purposes of man. Like all that we have done here during this time is so that God can be glorified, and that if we exalt him, he promises that he would bring all men unto himself. And so we will continue that. Tay, how are we going to do VBS and you don't come back until March? I don't know. We going to get it done, right? It's a staple of who we are as a church. Many capable leaders are in place now. We have so many of our ministry leaders who have carried the weight, even in this last year, of the ups and downs of my schedule and my life. They will continue to do that. And what this will give is many time for you all to rise up and to become some of those ministry leaders as well in this season of great need. I thank you. I thank you for your love. I thank you for your prayers, for your gifts, for your calls, for your consistency in being the body. I thank you for all the meals that you have dropped by. And if any of you here today have dropped by and you're missing Tupperware, it's in my garage. You can start to come and get it. Or if you need some for Thanksgiving, I have plenty. Thank you so much. And thank you for the opportunity to shepherd out of joy and out of hardship. I'm doing probably one of the hardest things I've probably done in life, and that is to be near to someone you love and not know what that next season will look like. But also to step away from something that I absolutely love, that the Lord has called me to. And so I will be praying for you all. I know you will be praying for me. And so in the next couple of weeks, we'll have a definite answer and plan of what it looks like, with maybe a return in the late of March for me back to full-time ministry. And I end with this before we jump in into our time together. This battle is the Lord's. And I have hope, and I have faith, and we have peace. And I've said it time after time. Rather Samantha lives, she will live. And we pray to God that it is here on earth, but if not, she lives in the presence of the Lord that she absolutely loves. And so we do not give up hope. We do not tire in praying, friends. We do not tire in praying for the Lord to move. We know that he is a God of miracles. And so for that, we are praying for, and our faith is in him. So thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for listening to that and for your love for us. Well, today looks a little different, really kind of more of a devotional style of a message. I just want to chat through a few scriptures, kind of topical, around this theme of Thanksgiving. And the heart behind this is that it is more than a day. All right? Although I am grateful for the time you and I have off work to be with family, and family begin to travel in, or you begin to travel. The day is great. Don't get me wrong. There's tons of family conversations and food and football. And anybody play turkey bowl with your family? Oh, just a few, yes. You get out in the yard and you make your own football game, and then you go and eat all the good food. But I really want us to walk away with a lifestyle, help develop this lifestyle of thankfulness and Thanksgiving. And I think this is born for me out of some moments this week that I recently had with God that convicted me, which we'll talk about a little more later, but this continuous lifestyle of Thanksgiving. In his book, Folk Psalms of Faith, Ray Steadman tells his experience with R.A. Ironside. Harry Ironside, fantastic theologian, pastor at one time at Moody Church. He was in a crowded restaurant, and just as Ironside was sat down to his meal, a man approached him and asked, "Hey, could I come and join you?" And at that point, Ironside, of course, invited him to have a seat. And as it was his custom, before he began to eat, he bowed his head in prayer, and he opened up his eyes, and the other man asked him, "Do you have a headache?" He said, "No, I do not." The man said, "Well, is there something wrong with your food?" Ironside replied, "No, I was simply thanking God, as I always do before I eat." The man said, "Oh, you're one of those, are you? Well, I want you to know that I never give thanks. I earn my money by the sweat of my brow, and I don't have to give thanks to anybody when I eat. I just jump straight in." Ironside looked at him and says, "You're just like my dog. He does that too." Friends, what a lesson to be gained and learned from this humorous story. And here's the lesson I compacted into kind of a theme or a teaching point for us today. It is this, that our Thanksgiving, must be grounded in the goodness of our God. The reason, the why we give thanks has to be the absolute fundamental pillar because God has been good to us. Now, I know this may seem maybe like a juvenile statement or not a Cambridge intellectual level of thought, but that resonated with me in that story because we all, I know I have faced the temptation, the cultural influences, and my sinful heart at times to think all that I have is because of me. And there is a little truth in that. Like, we go out and we use our brains and our hands, of course, to work. And the things we have in our home or in our family, of course, has been by the dedication of our hard work and our loved ones. There's no doubt to that. But when we take the 30,000-foot view and we look at all that we have, the functionalities of our body, the life that we live, the comfort of our nations, I mean, everything in our lives, it comes back to it is all because of God's goodness to his children. The end. When you go through the Psalms over and over again in the seasons of lament, but also in the seasons of praise, you see the thought, the Lord is good. It's a full stop to that statement. Our thanksgiving is grounded in the goodness of God. Friends, everything we own, everything we have, what we live in, what we ride in, what we eat with, what we wear, what we use, our family, etc., is a gift from God. And thanksgiving means that we grow in a repeated cycle or a lifestyle of us realizing we have nothing without the Lord's provision and his grace upon our lives, and we should forever have a posture of this, Lord, I am so thankful. Couple of scriptures that I'm just going to walk us through, and then we'll spend some time praying in Psalm number 100. Psalm number 100, this is a psalm of thanksgiving. It is actually a beautiful hymn, a song of thanksgiving, which parallels very well to Psalm number 95, which starts by summoning us to worship. And this is all God's people. It says this, so make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. Here's why. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. It summons God's people to now come and experience a life of worship and praise. And this is not just to the Israelites, but this is to all the nations. Now, very clear, as some of the writing of the Psalms depicts the language of God's chosen people, it says, this one, though, all people are called to live with gladness and thanksgiving as we ought to enthusiastically live a lifestyle of praising God. And here in verse 3, you see the reason their call of Israel, it says this, know that he is God. I love the confession in which we find here in this psalm. The confession is this, they had to make a pretty clear declaration. Israel would have had to make a pretty clear declaration of who their God was. They wrestled for years and generation after generation where they struggled to make the right God their heart. They would put all of these idols in place. And at this point, when we come to praise him, it is the acknowledgement, in their case, that Yahweh, he is God. That was a moment of a recognition that the God above all gods is their God and is their Lord. And today, for us, what that means for us is God the Father wants to be known and to be worshiped in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that we know him to be our absolute God. And with that, we enter then into both corporate worship as well as in private worship. Private worship within your home. And that has to be motivated by, I love this here at the end of verse 4, by us giving thanks to him and blessing his name. Like a moment for us to bless his name because of his goodness, because of his steadfast love, because of his faithfulness to us, and because that doesn't just stop with my generation. It's going to endure all generations. I said this week, as I looked at my beautiful children, I know the scripture is very clear. We will never see the righteous forsaken, nor the seed of those begging for bread. The Lord promised that he would take care of his children as we walk in him. And so we give thanks. And what we find here in this beautiful hymn of thanksgiving and praise is this. In the Old Testament, generally, both praise and thanksgiving are parts of the same. And the aim for both praise and thanksgiving is to do one thing. It is to exalt and glorify God, and the two belong together, both thanksgiving and praise. To exalt and to glorify God. And so here's why we do that. Because God is our source for everything. He is our source for everything. Thanksgiving is more directly focused on what God has done and the experience of one giving the thanksgiving. But praise is also arising from a full awareness of what God has done and what he will continue to do. And this is this ongoing process of praising our good God. Flip over to Psalm 103. Look at this beautiful portion of this psalm. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Because God is the source of everything, I'm going to bless him with all that I have. Bless the Lord, O my soul, all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not his benefits, who forgives your iniquities, who heals your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good thing, so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. You know, we do when we give thanks, friends. By giving thanks, we recognize and we accept God's blessings. We pause. And we focus our mind. If Ironside's story is so true, when we pause, for even for what we're about to eat, where we're about to sleep, where we're about to go, our coming in and our going out, it focuses on to accept and to recognize God's choice blessings. Go over to Psalm 107. Psalm 107. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Why? Again. For he is good. Our thanksgiving has to be grounded in the goodness of God. For he is good. For his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west and from the north and from the south. We recognize this. We see in Psalm 107 now, this call to celebrate from the perspective that we are redeemed, that we are now exiles. Now, of course, during this time, this was written to generations of Israelites after the first and second. They would have hey, you are now exiles from the bondage of slavery. Like, you've been set free. The language is, you've been absolutely redeemed. And the perspective here is that all the nations have been gathered throughout the lands and to give praise and steadfast love to God. And at this moment, I love this picture. A worship leader would have got up in front of the congregation and they would have introduced this psalm, and they would have summoned the people to say so, like a audible say of, wow, I'm giving thanks to God because I am absolutely redeemed. And for us today, we chart that through our redemption that happened through Jesus Christ. Because of our great sin, because of our great disobedience, because we missed the mark, because we missed walking in all of his ways, there had to be a penalty for our sin. And that person, of course, was Jesus Christ. And that came within a free gift to you and I for those who believe. He promised that he would now live inside of us and we will walk in him. The worship leader will call them to say so, to tell of their story from their perspective, to tell of the story to their children, to put a testimony in their mouth referring to themselves that this is where we used to be, but look how God has brought us. To be redeemed from slavery, this was without a payment of their own, but it had to be the payment of another. And so, friends, when we give thanks, to God, it enlarges our vision and concept of who God really is. Isaiah 62:12, this power of God, where it talks literally, the literal hand of God hath saved us from our enemy, and then has gathered us up. Our minds are blown. Laura, as you were sharing, like, our eyes are open when we pause to thank God. The concept of who he is. Like, wait, you're the God who is putting all things into order. Right now, he is sustaining it by his word and his powerful hand. Yet, we can call on him and he hears us. And he doesn't have to pause one section of earth to say, wait, let me tend to my folks here in Carroll Stream. It opens up our eyes of who he really, really is. And that's our deep hope, is that, Lord, we are going to trust in you because you are big and you are a good God. Let me continue on. Look back at Psalm 107, verse 13 to 15. And then I'll close soon. But also this, we see even in the midst of suffering and trouble and the perils of life, we ought to give thanks. Again, recounting the history of some of Israel's time in bondage. Verse 13, then they cried to the Lord in their trouble. They had stuff going on in life. Every day wasn't peachy. Every day wasn't joyful. They cried to the Lord in the day of their trouble. They were wounded. They were afflicted. They had pain. They had trials. They called on the trouble. And he brought them out of darkness in the shadow of death. And he burst their bonds apart. So, verse 15, let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wondrous works to the children of man. Oh, friends, even in the midst of suffering and trouble and the perils of life, our call is to thank God. And so what that means for you and I is to learn to give thanks to God during a difficult time or a crisis. And this is the greatest challenge for the believer. Oh, Lord, I've yielded my life to you, and this is the return you give. Oh, Lord, why? Lord, I'm walking in all of your ways. It seemed like this is absolutely unfair. Lord, I've tried to be honored. I honored my parents. I've took care of my family and my children. Lord, why? And what we know is that the Lord gets the glory out of our trouble, out of our pain, out of our suffering, and we look more like Jesus when we suffer. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says this, in everything give thanks. Every moment of life, every season you're in, give thanks. When that snow is getting ready to be deep, I'm sure in a couple weeks, that will not be a moment for those of us who hate winter to give thanks. We will quickly say, it's going to be fun, but I want to get over it. There are seasons in life, whether it's the winter months and the summer months and the fall months and the spring months, where it's blooming, where it's dying, where it's cold, where it's resetting, where it's lively. He says, in all seasons of life, give thanks, for this is the will of God. The will of God is to live in thanksgiving and concerning Christ Jesus in you. In the sermon at the Emmanuel Presbyterian Church in Los Angeles, one of the pastors was reminded of a story by the name of Martin Reinhardt. You see, he was a pastor in Germany during the 30 Years' War. And it is said that he had buried 5,000 of his parishioners within 1 year. And on that, it was an average of 15 a day. And his parish was ravaged by war and by death and by economic disaster. And in the heart of this darkness, with the crisis of the fear outside his own window, he sat down and he wrote at the table of grace or prayer for his children. Here was that prayer. It says this, now thank we all our God with heart and hands and voices, who wondrous things has done. In him his world rejoices, who from our mother's arms has led us all the way with countless gifts of love, and still he would do it today. Here was a man that in the moment of pain, he stilled, prayed, and lived with thanksgiving, to know that thanksgiving comes from God, not from the outer appearances. With war and people being lost. Man, think about Paul. Think about Paul. Paul, even in prison, Paul did not regard as being such a bitter experience. You know what he did? He took advantage of it. And from that prison, he wrote some of the most beautiful letters we have in scriptures to the churches that encourages our hearts to walk in Jesus. He led the church leaders in Asia Minor. What about Psalm 40, 31? Reminds us that they that wait upon the Lord, they shall have their strength renewed. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And even after the situation of darkness, trouble, and peril, you know what our call is? Is to recall the goodness of God. Renee, you hit on this morning. As I read Philippians 4, 6, what it reminds me is to let us not forget to give thanks even when God answers. When he comes through just how we prayed, we give thanks. And then, of course, in closing, we always give thanks to our Lord for the greatest gift of all. And that greatest gift of all that we all get to enjoy for those who believe in him is eternal life. That there is life after this life. As a matter of fact, the life after this life we here on earth will be better than the life we live here, and all of his spiritual blessings we have received in him. Look at Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9 through 12. You want to talk about the multitude of God's people to come together? After this, I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and people and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robe with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their face before the throne and they worshiped God. What did they say? What would this look like saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. What a beautiful moment when we realize the surest, the greatest part of our thanksgiving is he giving us the greatest gift, Jesus, to come and die for our sins and make us whole. Former President Abraham Lincoln said this in his 1863 Thanksgiving Proclamation, a portion of this, you can go and read it online, it's really beautiful. He says, we have been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. No human counsel has devised it, nor have any mortal hand have worked out these great things. You know what they are? He says, they are gracious gifts from the Most High God, who, while dealing with us in anger for our sins, has nevertheless remembered us with mercy. And then he called the United States of America to live a life of thanksgiving. And so, friends, that's what I want to do at this moment. This week, I found myself very convicted. In the season of life, of course, that I am in, I was praying, of course, for our situation to turn around. And I spent time crying and warring in prayer and on my knees, and others coming to our home and calling some of my closest friends to walk this journey with me. And that's not a bad thing. But what I realized in my time of prayer and my calling on the Lord in deep agony, despair, and desperation, It convicted me that I probably only do this when I have a need. I probably only have these deep emotions when I want God to turn around. Friend, there's nothing wrong with that. God can handle all of those things for sure. There's nothing wrong with that. But in my full stop, I had to stop and say, Lord, have I ever given this emotion or time to prayer or focusing in just with one simple word of thank you? I want nothing of this prayer now. When I pray to my daddy, my heavenly father, that he hears my heart of thanksgiving. I want to use the same emotions of while I'm praying for him to turn around to be stuck in awe of him with praise and thanksgiving every day. And so what I want to do for the next couple of minutes that we have in here, and then we'll get out, is I want to make our sanctuary into a prayer room of one thing, of thanksgiving and praise. Now, this week I wrote four prayer prompts, and they're going to be on the screen. And if you want them, I can email them to you. I've attached scripture to all of them as well. And I'm going to walk us through one prayer prompt at a time. And you're just going to pray silently where you are. If your family is around and you want a space in the sanctuary and you want to crowd up with your family, you can do that. Your small group is around, you want to do that. Or if you just want some personal time as well. I think my heart is this. I was convicted in this, and I want to lead us and model this well of what is our prayers of thanksgiving. You can stand, you can kneel, you can sit, you can bow your head, you can stare up at the ceiling, whatever you feel comfortable in doing. Let's do that now. Number one, prayer prompt number one. We give thanks for our most precious and joyous moments we've had this year. Here we are in November, the year soon to come to end, next couple months. Would you begin to give thanks? Maybe it was a vacation, maybe it was a meal, maybe it was time with family, one of your most precious moments you've had this year. Love and goodness to us. Thank you, Lord. Prayer prompt number two. We give thanks for His enduring presence, for His provisions, and His peace in our toughest times this year. James tells us in all trials, have joy. 1 Thessalonians, pray without ceasing. Would you even recall the times of hardships and how you've seen His presence, provision, and peace? Give thanks for how the Lord has blessed us with the things that we have and that He has met our everyday needs. Thanks for the surety of our salvation, which is in Jesus Christ alone, and our faith community. God, we pour out to You a heart of gratefulness. Desire now, God, is not to ask for anything, but to absolutely thank You for everything. You are a most high God who loves and cares for us. And Lord, it has been evident in all of our years, but Lord, this year it's a pause to reflect, to be thankful, to tell You how much we love You and are thankful for Your kindness to us. But I pray every time we pray that there is a strong emotion of declaring your thankfulness to us. Lord, we don't want to be like the guy in the restaurant who says all that we have is because of us. Lord, you've given us abilities to work hard and use our brains and care for our families, to have the basic necessities of life, Lord. And then you give us a little extra to get out the things that we want. Think about Matthew 26, Lord, where it talks about how you care for even the birds of the air, that they don't have to worry where they're going to sleep or where they're going to eat. How much more are you going to care and take care of us? And Lord, thank you for your people who've made bold faith proclamations and step to say, I'm trusting in this good news that has saved me, redeemed me, justified me, and now call the sons and daughters of God. Lord, we hold on to that. We're your people. Show the world what it means to live in love, peace, joy, thanksgiving for all you have done for us. Lord, may this week, as we be with families, people begin to travel, people begin to come in. May the tone around the home, may the temperature around the table, even in the moments of pain, recall your love lavish upon us. We absolutely love you and we thank you in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Let's sing that together. God, that's our prayer this morning. We just want to thank you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this time. As we go from this place, Lord, would you go before us? Would you be glorified? And would we continue in this state of thanksgiving, Lord, overflowing with thankfulness this week? Thank you, Lord. In your name we pray. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.